This audiobook was created using text-to-speech software, and was not read by a real person. Please keep in mind the limitations of the technology when it comes to pacing and pronunciation. Thank you for listening, and we hope you enjoy the story. Star Wars Rebel Force Book 1 Target Written by Alex Wheeler. Preview. The Death Star has been destroyed, and the Empire is determined to find the pilot responsible and eliminate them. Meanwhile, Luke Skywalker, Han Solo, and Princess Leia are sent on a secret mission to the planet Muunilinst. And when they arrive, the Empire's top assassin will be waiting. Chapter 1 The Emperor closed his eyes and let the rage consume him. An energy bolt of anger crackled across his body, turning his blood black with venom. A red mist clouded the darkness behind his lids. The fog of hate would have shrouded the vision of a lesser man. But when the Emperor opened his eyes, the blood-tinged world was sharper than ever. Clarity. Understanding. Power. This was what the rage could do for him. This was what pathetic Jedi had never understood, as they rejected their anger, letting cowardice block their path to the dark side. This was why they had been eliminated, and why the Emperor reigned supreme, his power unquestioned. His iron rule, unassailable. Until now. My lord, the Death Star has been destroyed. The Emperor played with his memory of the moment, polishing it in his mind like a precious gem. Remembering Darth Vader's voice as he delivered the news. Vader's anger, so forceful the Emperor could feel it from halfway across the galaxy. And with the anger, terror, for Vader knew how terribly he had disappointed his master. Vader knew it was not the first time. The Emperor curled his fingers into a gnarled fist. The Death Star, his most powerful weapon, perhaps the greatest achievement of his reign, the key to destroying the tedious Rebel Alliance once and for all. Destroyed. Even now, the detestable rebels were no doubt celebrating their victory. It was a meaningless victory, of course, and only a fool would think differently. But then, only a fool would join the ridiculous battle against the Empire. Only a fool challenges the inevitable. The Rebel Alliance was nothing but a nuisance, a millfly to be swatted away. But even a meaningless victory was unacceptable. The rebels would be punished. The Emperor smiled, the rebels would be crushed. And soon. His impatience swelled. Fury boiled his blood at the thought of waiting any longer. The rage called for release, and the Emperor knew that with a thought he could destroy his opulent office. He could crack the building's foundation, rain rubble on the heads of those unlucky beings trapped within. He could, with the full power of his anger, unleash a fireball of death. But he chose to wait. He chose control. It was another thing the Jedi had never understood. A lesson that even Darth Vader, such a quick study in the School of Darkness, had yet to learn. The rage was only a beginning. Control, that was the key. Patience. The ability to channel the flood, bend it to your will. Anger was the fuel that powered the dark side of the Force. But success depended on mastery of the anger. Vader spent his anger without thought, the Emperor hoarded his, as a hut hoarded his treasure. The destruction of the Death Star had been a setback, but every defeat masked an opportunity. And this was an opportunity the Emperor fully intended to seize. In fact, he already had a plan. The Emperor activated his comm console, opening a line of communication to the lieutenant who sat quivering just outside the door, waiting on his command. Send them in. 10 of the most powerful men and women in the galaxy faced the Emperor, fear rolling off of them, in waves. These were beings who could destroy ships, or cities, with a single word. Their hearts knew no mercy, their lives were founded on cruelties great and small, their names struck terror in their enemies. And yet, they trembled before him, made small and weak, by their own fear. The most elite members of his royal guard flanked the group, their expressions hidden by their featureless scarlet masks. The emperor had taken great pains to ensure that his throne room was an awesome and intimidating sight, from the towering walls to the gleaming dais. Behind his shadowed throne, a wall of permaplast windows looked into the heart of the Coruscant Knight. But his servants ignored the trappings of power. All attention was fixed on the emperor. "The Death Star has been destroyed," he informed them, carefully noting their reactions. Captain Thrawn betrayed no emotion. "Complete control," the emperor thought with approval. "This one will go far." Krix Maydeen, leader of the elite Storm Commandos, frowned, conflicted emotions swirling deep beneath his surface. The fool thought he could hide his doubts from the emperor. This foolishness would prove useful, thus the emperor allowed it. "For now." Commander Grev Tran looked somber at the news. But before the expression dropped across his face, the emperor had sensed something else. The beginnings of a smile. Such a small thing, a tensed muscle, a nearly imperceptible flinch, but it was enough. The emperor had had his suspicions about Tran. Now they were confirmed. He raised a finger, catching the attention of the royal guard. Then nodded. Tran's face paled as one of the guards peeled away from the line. His crimson robes swept the floor as he padded silently toward the traitor. The other officers looked away, their faces grim. "No." Tran drew his blaster. "You can't." The guard's force pike jabbed into Tran's neck, silencing him forever. His body shuddered once, then dropped to the ground. The silent red figure waited on the emperor's command, but the emperor shook his head. They could take out the garbage later. For now, let the traitor stay where he was. It would serve as a helpful reminder. "How did it happen, sir?" one of the officers asked. "The Death Star was invincible." "So we were led to believe," the emperor agreed. He peered closely at the man who had spoken. His face was blank, his features composed into a perfect mask of calm loyalty. But there was something beneath the surface. Not betrayal, no. But something, the emperor reached out with the dark side of the force, probing the man's depths. "The rebels found a weakness," the emperor said, searching for a reaction that would reveal the truth. "Wisely, they exploited it." Quickly, he ran through what he knew of the man. Rezi Sorish, of the planet Dryzen. A loyal, if plotting commander. His brilliance blunted, by blind obedience. Just as the emperor preferred it. Cold, ambitious, cautious, not the kind of man to speak up first, or at all, when silence would serve him better. And in the emperor's presence, silence always served better. "Were there any survivors?" Sorish asked. There was a disturbance in the force as something flared within him, something sharp and bright. Hope. Ah, yes. It made sense now. Rezi Sorish, husband to Alani Sorish, father to Kimali Sorish. Or, was. 2 years before, fresh out of the academy, Kimali had fallen in with a group of rebel sympathizers. When the group came under suspicion, his mother had helped him evade arrest. She had procured him the text docs he would need to run away and take on a new identity, and then she revealed the truth to Sorish, giving him the chance to say a final farewell to his son. Sorish had turned them both in. His reward, a promotion to commander. His family's reward, a life sentence in the Gree Bakir labor camp. Several prisoner work squads had been assigned to the Death Star, the emperor now remembered. Among them, the prisoners from Gree Bakir. The emperor smiled. No survivors. Sorish's face remained blank, as his hope died. The emperor suspected that Sorish himself was ignorant of the emotions that roiled beneath his surface. Likely, he thought he had left his family, and his guilt, far behind. The emperor knew better. Only Lord Vader escaped, he added, enjoying the disappointment that filled the room. He of course knew of the petty jealousies directed at his most favorite subordinate. No one could hope to understand the bond that existed between a Sith master and his dark apprentice. Darth Vader had failed him before, and would surely fail again, but he remained the Emperor's only option. True, if there were another, a being with Vader's power and potential, a Jedi with a susceptible mind and a healthy body who could rule by his master's side, Vader would become disposable. But the Jedi were gone forever. He had seen to that. Lord Vader is making his way back to Coruscant, the Emperor said. And when he returns, we will make arrangements to eradicate the rebel threat, once and for all. But sir, why wait? Captain Thrawn asked. We know the location of the rebel base. Surely we can. We can do many things, the Emperor said coolly, enjoying the way even Thrawn cowered before his glare. We will bide our time. I will not risk generating sympathy for the rebellion. When it is crushed, it must be crushed completely. This does not, however, mean we will do nothing. He pointed a spindly finger at the line of officers. You will identify the top rebel leaders. You will use this knowledge to destroy them, thus ensuring that the alliance begins to crumble from within. And you will discover the name of the pilot responsible for destroying the Death Star. The Emperor savored the rage that burned within him at the thought of it. The pilot will die, and whoever makes this possible will find himself richly rewarded. Again, he probed the emotions of his officers. Beneath their fear, and their hatred, he sensed loyalty. An eagerness to act. They wanted to please him. But Sorish wanted more than that. He wanted to kill, a bloodlust for the man who had slaughtered his family. Good, the Emperor thought. Loyalty was useful. Vengeance more so. The officers filed out, followed by the Red Guard, leaving the Emperor alone with his thoughts. Things were proceeding as they should, he realized now. As they must. He would never doubt the power of the dark side of the Force, to show him the way forward. The destruction of the Death Star was surely necessary, as it would guide him to this new path. Darkness was gathering, and the Emperor sensed that this pilot was at the heart of it. The dark side of the Force had brought him to light. The Emperor had only to find him, and the Emperor would find him. He knew that, with an iron certainty. The pilot would be found. An ordered galaxy would follow. It was his destiny. Chapter 2. Luke Skywalker tightened his grip on the lightsaber. Frozen in place, he held his breath, listening. It was too dark to see, but he could sense it out there somewhere, watching him. Playing with him. And at any moment. Ping. Luke sprang backward. The shot screamed past, singeing his cheek. He backed up against a tree, then lashed out with the lightsaber. The blue blade whirled up and around in a smooth, glowing arc. But it sliced through empty air. Ping, ping. His heart thudding, Luke whipped the lightsaber from side to side, struggling to block the blasts. He was always an instant too late. He took a deep breath and warned himself not to panic. Use the Force, Luke. He imagined he could hear old Ben Kenobi advising him, but of course it was only his imagination. Ben was dead. Still, Luke tried to feel the Force. Ben had said it was all around him, that he need only reach for it, and it would be there. Luke reached. Nothing. But then, a crackling sound, off to his right. Like a twig being crushed. And something else, a small click. Like a weapon being cocked. Luke lunged to his right, slashing down with the lightsaber in a single, fluid motion. More shots streaked past, and Luke spun around, sweeping the glowing saber from one side to the other, deflecting the spray. Grinning, Luke raised the lightsaber over his head, ready to deflect the next barrage of fire. But instead of slicing through air, the weapon struck something solid. There was a slow, loud crack. Luke tensed, then, realizing what was about to happen, leaped out of the way. Too late, again. The blow came to the back of his head. Luke dropped the lightsaber and went down, slamming hard into the overgrown jungle weeds. A heavy weight landed on top of him, pinning him down. His fingers scraped the ground, searching for the fallen saber, but came up with nothing but dirt. A soft click, as his assailant readied his weapon. "No," Luke screamed. "Don't." "Direct hit." "Ow," Luke complained. It may have been just a sting burst, but a direct hit to the shoulder still hurt. He whipped off his blindfold and glared at R2-D2, who came rolling out from behind the tree, looking as pleased with himself as an astromech droid could look. "R2, that's not fair." Luke gestured at the tree branch pinning him flat on his back. "I couldn't block the shot like this, could I? You should have waited for me to get up." R2-D2 released a trill of beeps and whistles. Luke sighed. He'd spent enough time around the droid to guess what he was trying to say. "I know, I know. In a real fight, the enemy wouldn't wait for me to be ready. Not to mention that in a real fight, the enemy would be shooting a blaster, rather than sting bursts, and Luke would be dead." Now that Luke could see again, he spotted his lightsaber lying in a puddle of mud. He stretched out an arm for it, but the weapon was just beyond his reach. "Bring me the lightsaber," he commanded the Force, searching inside himself for the power to move objects with his mind. "Lightsaber." But the lightsaber stayed where it was. And Luke stayed where he was. Trapped. "Come on, R2, he finally said. "Help me out here." R2-D2 beeped again, but didn't move. Luke sighed. The astromech droid may have been his most loyal companion, but he was also more than a little sensitive. "Okay, I'm sorry I said you weren't playing fair," he apologized. "You were just doing what I told you to do. You did a good job." The droid beeped happily and rolled toward Luke, nudging the lightsaber into his outstretched hand. Soon Luke had sliced away enough of the heavy bough to climb out from under it. He stood up and dusted himself off. All around him, the lush green jungle rustled and chirped, alive with the calls of woolamanders and whisper birds, gackle bats, clicknicks, and the many other species native to Yavin 4. Luke couldn't help feeling like they were all laughing at him. Better them than Han, he thought, switching off his lightsaber and sliding it back into the holster hanging at his waist. They'd been at the rebel base for almost 2 weeks now, which meant 2 weeks of fruitless lightsaber practice. And 2 weeks of being laughed at by Han Solo, who was convinced the lightsaber wasn't good for anything but slicing Sweezenberry bread. Luke knew Han meant well, and that he was probably right about the lightsaber, at least when Luke was the one wielding it. Still, Luke had decided it might be better to practice in the jungle, with no one to watch him but R2-D2 and the towering Misasi trees. He'd need a lot more practice if he was ever going to be a Jedi master like Ben Kenobi. "Obi-Wan Kenobi," Luke corrected himself. It was still hard to believe that the strange old hermit was actually the last of the great Jedi Knights, and a friend to Luke's father. "I will find a way to follow in my father's footsteps," Luke promised himself, resting a hand on his lightsaber. "It's my destiny." But at times like this, that seemed impossible. He felt he would never learn to wield his lightsaber with Ben's grace and skill. And even that wasn't enough for Ben, not in the end. Luke shook his head, trying to clear it of the images. Ben's lightsaber slashing through the air, sizzling with energy as it clashed against the red beam of Darth Vader's weapon. Ben, struggling to match Vader blow for blow, struggling, and failing. Ben raising his arms in surrender, meeting Luke's eyes one last time. Vader's lightsaber slicing through Ben like he was as insubstantial as air. Ben's robes falling to the ground, his body vanished. Ben, gone. And Luke alone. Again. He couldn't stop to think about all he'd lost, or he might never get started again. His comlink beeped, driving away the dark thoughts. "Where are you, kid?" Han's familiar voice asked. Leia's been looking everywhere for you. Luke grinned, glad there was no one but R2-D2 and a few mucus salamanders around to see how pleased he was to hear that. Ever since he had rescued Leia Organa, since he and Han had rescued her, from the Death Star, Luke had felt a special connection to the Alderaan princess. Unfortunately, Han seemed to feel one too. Then why didn't she call me? Luke asked. Guess Her Highness has better things to do, Han joked. Or maybe she's just afraid to get too close when you're waving around that lightsaber. Luke glared at R2-D2. How did you know I? Blame 3PO, Han said, referring to C-3PO, the protocol droid Luke had acquired back on Tatooine, along with R2-D2. Wherever one went, the other usually followed. 3PO had been more than a little upset that he hadn't been invited along on the jungle training mission. That bucket of bolts has a bigger mouth than a whippet. Well, tell Leia you found me, and I'm fine, Luke said, annoyed. Tell her yourself, kid, Han said. General Dodonna's called some kind of top priority meeting back at Base 1, and we're the guests of honor. Thousands of years earlier, the primitive tribe occupying Yavin 4 had erected several enormous temples across the jungle moon. The largest of these, the Great Temple, was a massive, terraced pyramid whose moss-spotted stone walls broke through the clouds. From the outside, it seemed as ancient and weathered as the moon itself, as if a sacred, mystical secret lay within. But the building had recently been restored and modernized, complete with turbolifts, computers, and lookout posts, as befit the nerve center of the Rebel Alliance. Luke rode the makeshift turbolift to the top floor. He couldn't believe that only a few weeks before he'd been a farm boy on Tatooine, a nobody stranded in a nothing life. Now he was about to enter a meeting with Jan Dodonna, the leader of the Rebel Alliance military. And why not? Luke was, after all, a hero. With the help of his friends, he'd blown up the Death Star. He'd saved Yavin 4, and possibly the rebellion itself. Still, when he stepped into the conference room and saw Dodonna, Han, Leia, and a handful of top rebel leaders staring back at him, he couldn't help it. He felt like a clueless kid. General Dodonna barely waited for Luke to sit down before he began speaking. Our spies have intercepted a coded Imperial transmission, indicating the Empire has no imminent plans to attack Yavin 4. But why? Leia cut in. Now that they have our location, it doesn't make sense that they wouldn't attack us. Agreed. Dodonna ran a hand through his bushy beard. We gave them a nasty surprise when we blew up the Death Star, but we didn't expect it would take them this long to regroup. They're planning something, but by the time they act, we will have established a new base far from here. I have ships scouring the galaxy for an appropriate location. We'd be happy to help in any way we can, General, Leia said. Han shot her a look. We? He mouthed. The general shook his head. I'm afraid that's not why I've called you here. We learned something else from the transmission. Although they're not moving on Yavin 4, the Empire is determined to retaliate for the blow we struck against the Death Star. They're planning targeted attacks to take out our top leadership, among others. As you can imagine, there's one target the Emperor wants most of all. As Luke waited for General Dodonna to reveal the target, he suddenly realized that everyone in the room was looking at him. What? It's you, kid, Han said. Imperial enemy number one. I'm afraid so, General Dodonna confirmed. Luke wasn't sure whether he should feel proud or terrified. According to our sources, the Empire doesn't yet have Luke's name. As of today, we're instituting several new security protocols, designed to shield the identities of anyone who might be an Imperial target, the general explained. All of your roles in the destruction of the Death Star have been reclassified as top secret. Obviously, your identities are known to most of the rebels on Yavin 4, but everyone involved understands how crucial secrecy is to the rebel cause. What happens if the Empire finds out? Luke asked. Don't you mean when they find out? Han shot back. Leia stood up, smacking her hands against the conference table. "Then we face them together, and we defeat them." She sounded almost eager for the chance. Luke and Han exchanged a glance. Leia was a former Imperial senator, a well-known diplomat, who, in her official capacity, traveled the galaxy, carrying messages of comfort and peace. But sometimes Luke suspected that deep down, she was the most natural-born warrior of them all. Chapter 3. When they emerged from Base 1, Chewbacca and the droids were waiting. "Come on, Chewie," Han said, barely pausing to collect the Wookiee. "Let's go." "Go where?" Luke asked, hurrying after them. "Where do you think?" Han asked, sounding surprised by the question. "I'm taking myself and my ship." Chewbacca roared indignantly. "Of course, you too, Chewie." "What? You think I'd leave my co-pilot here to get blasted to bits when the Empire shows up? We'll jump into hyperspace and be halfway across the galaxy by dinner time." Han stopped and turned to Luke, jabbing him in the chest. "And if you're smart, kid, you'll come along for the ride. I've got to admit, you're not a half-bad pilot. A few sloppy habits, but you could come in handy once we get a little training into you." "Not half-bad," Luke repeated. "I could fly better than you blindfolded and with one arm tied behind my back." Han just laughed. "Kid, I was out flying wannabe spice smugglers on the Kessel Run at 0.5 light speed, back when you were still picking up bantha droppings on Tatooine. I was a good enough pilot to destroy the Death Star," Luke pointed out. "Lucky shot," Han said. "Happens to the best of us, and the rest of us." Luke fell silent. He knew Han was just teasing, but he'd managed to hit on Luke's greatest fear. Maybe he'd been meant to make that shot, maybe the Force had steered him toward his destiny, just like Obi-Wan had predicted. Or maybe it was just dumb luck. "Luke may be inexperienced," Leia admitted. "Inexperienced?" Luke repeated in disbelief. So even Leia didn't believe in him. "But at least he's not running away." Leia glared at Han, daring him to argue. "Who said anything about running away?" he countered. Chewbacca barked again, giving Han a pointed look. "Hey, there's a difference," Han insisted. "I never said I'd be sticking around forever, did I? There's no money to be made here, and if I don't pay Jabba back soon, I'm dead. But that does not mean I'm running away, Your Worshipfulness. Only cowards run away." Leia looked skeptical. "So what would you call it?"
"I'd call it being smart."
"You?" Leia smirked.
"Smart?"
Han ignored her bait. He turned to Luke, serious for once. "Look, kid, you heard the general in there. The Empire's gunning for you. Only thing to do now is disappear."
"The Empire's gunning for a mystery man," Luke pointed out. "No one knows that I'm the pilot they're looking for."
Han threw up his arms in disgust. "Kid, look around, everyone on this whole moon knows."
"The new security protocols will take care of that," Leia pointed out.
"You trust security protocols if you want," Han said.
"I trust my gut. And my gut says when this many people know a secret, it won't be a secret for long."
"Master Luke, I'm inclined to agree with Captain Solo," C-3PO put in, sounding agitated. "When you say that the Empire is gunning for you, well, that sounds like a situation that could end rather unhappily, don't you think? Perhaps we'd be safer somewhere else, away from all this troublesome fighting."
R2-D2 let off a long string of beeps.
C-3PO looked infuriated.
"That's all well and good for you to say," he told the droid, "but some of us are designed for dignified intergalactic summit negotiations, not—" his voice took on a disgusted note, "space battles. I am, after all, a protocol droid fluent in over 6 million forms of communication and equipped with—"
"We know, 3PO, Luke said wearily. The droid gave some version of this speech at least once a day. "And I'm sorry I got you mixed up in this. But we're in it now. And I'm not running away,
no matter how dangerous it may be. I'm a rebel, and I'm going to stick around and fight. That's what a Jedi would do, right, Ben? He thought. But of course there was no answer. At two crucial moments, he thought he heard Ben speak to him from beyond the grave. But it had never happened since. Luke was beginning to think it may just have been his imagination. You see, Luke's not afraid, Leia said proudly. Luke grinned. Running away from the guy with the blaster pointed at your head isn't fear, Your Highness, Han retorted. It's smarts. Or did they not teach you that in princess school? I guess they were too busy teaching us the importance of fighting for what you believe in, even when the cause seems hopeless, Leia snapped. Or did they not teach you that in smuggler school? They taught me how to stay alive, princess. And that's all I'm trying to teach you. Oh my, how lucky I am to have met you, Leia gushed, affecting a high, fluttery voice. I don't know how I managed to make it this long without having a big, strong man like you around to keep me safe. Han shrugged. You said it, princess, not me. Come on, Han, Luke urged him. The rebellion could really use you. I won't be any good to the rebellion if I'm dead, Han said. And neither will you. We lift off in a few hours, you want to join us, you're welcome. You want to stick around here. Well, it's been nice knowing you, kid. You too, princess, he told Leia. He held out a hand for her to shake. She crossed her arms. Han snorted. Have it your way. Come on, Chewie. The Wookiee groaned a mournful goodbye as he followed Han to the main hangar deck. You don't think he'll really leave, do you? Luke asked, once they were gone. Han might be annoying sometimes, but he was still a good pilot, and a good friend. Luke didn't have many of those left. I hope he does, Leia said angrily. The sooner, the better. But Luke suspected she didn't mean it. Judging from the look on her face, she wanted Han to stick around as much as he did. Maybe more. You don't think he's right, do you? Luke asked nervously. Not a chance. There is, in fact, a 94.2% chance that Captain Solo is correct, C-3PO pointed out. Especially if you factor in. Not a chance, Leia repeated firmly. I believe in the Alliance. We will protect you, Luke. And, you know, I also believe in you. You do? Luke asked, flushing with pleasure. Of course, Leia said, like it should have been obvious. You've already proven you can stand up to the Empire and survive. The Death Star was the most powerful weapon they had. What could be worse than facing that? Luke shuddered. Let's hope we never have to find out. Commander Rezi Sorish had been waiting a long time for an opportunity like this. He knew what everyone thought of him. That he was all brain, no guts. That he was quick to obey but slow to initiate. He knew they laughed at him, as people had always laughed, and so they would pay, as people always paid. Even Alani had laughed at him, as if she. No, he thought. He would not think of the traitor or her son. Not at a time like this. He had work to do. This new mission was his chance to prove himself to the Emperor, once and for all. Once he stood by the great man's side, there would be no more laughter. None of the Emperor's officers could match Rezi's ambition, his intelligence, his determination. And certainly none could match his loyalty. The Emperor's goals were his goals, the Emperor's desires, the Emperor's will, his will. The Empire was his life. And he had proven that like no one else. Now he would prove it again, so thoroughly and so impressively that no one, not even the Emperor, would be able to ignore him. And no one would be able to laugh. The comlink beeped with an incoming transmission. Sorish put it up on the viewscreen. Hollow gray eyes stared out at him, deep set in a pale, angular face. The shaved head had been replaced by a shock of black hair, which made the man look more human. Looks could be deceiving. The man didn't speak. He merely waited for orders, he'd been well trained.
I have a job for you, Sorish said.
The man nodded, still waiting. It's too sensitive to discuss over a comm channel, Sorish told him.
How quickly can you get to Coruscant?
I have something to finish here, the man said.
Then I'll have to track down a ship.
His voice was empty of emotion. Like his face, it was blank, almost machine-like. As if he were a droid pretending to be human, and doing a poor job of it.
But Sorish, who knew him better than anyone, knew there were no mechanical parts hiding beneath the surface.
Beneath the surface there was nothing.
He sounded hollow because he was.
Sorish knew this, he'd made sure of it.
I can be there in 3 days, the man said.
Make it one.
Sorish flipped off the comlink without waiting for an answer.
He knew the man would obey. Soon he would arrive on Coruscant, and then Sorish would sick the hunter on his prey.
At the thought of it, an odd shiver of foreboding ran up his spine.
There was no reason for concern.
It was a foolproof plan, guaranteed to work.
And yet,
he had the dark feeling that he had just sealed his own doom.
The man with the hollow eyes was trained to kill.
He knew nothing else but the joy of the hunt.
And soon, he would have the pilot who destroyed the Death Star in his blaster sight.
So why did Sorish feel he'd just signed his own death warrant?
So be it, he thought, imagining his inner voice traveling across the dark emptiness of the galaxy, and whispering in the pilot's ear.
Then you and I shall die together.
Chapter 4.
We are nothing, he repeats, as he is told.
The light blinds him.
He opens his eyes wide, against the pain.
We are no one.
You belong to me, the commander says.
We belong to you.
They are seven.
But they are one.
One in mind.
One in obedience.
One in life.
They are no one.
Count off, the commander says.
The young men obey.
X1, shouts the first.
X2, the second, and down the line.
He waits.
And then, X7, he shouts.
The lights blink out.
Darkness.
Time to sleep, the commander says.
X7 braces for the blow.
It is always sooner than he expects.
Always harder.
Pain blossoms from the back of his head, blots out the world.
Time to sleep.
Once he'd plotted the course to Coruscant, X7 stretched out on his bunk, staring at the ceiling. The Preybird starfighter had seen better days, and it wasn't much for comfort or show, but the autopilot would take him where he needed to go.
At least, that's what the Rodian had boasted, before he died.
No need to go anywhere now, my friend, X7 had told the Rodian lying lifeless at his feet.
So I'm sure you won't mind if I take her for a spin.
Then he'd holstered the blaster and lifted off.
The commander wanted him on Coruscant within a day.
And what the commander wanted, the commander received.
For X7, these were words to live by.
Literally.
The stun cuffs pin him against the durasteel wall.
The light pierces his eyeballs, and the figure facing him is nothing more than a shadow.
But he knows it is the commander.
It is always the commander.
He does not struggle.
He only waits for this moment to pass, and then the next.
He dreads the future, the past is forbidden.
The present is his only home.
Who are you? The commander asks.
I am X7.
What is your purpose? The commander asks.
To serve you.
To what end? The commander asks.
To serve the Empire.
Where do you come from? The commander asks.
From nowhere.
Pain.
Everywhere at once.
It is born inside of him, exploding out of him, and then it is gone.
Where do you come from? The commander asks again.
I cannot remember. He gives the answer the commander wants to hear. Pain. Greater now, more intense, like a knife hollowing him out. Liar, the commander roars. Have you not yet learned it is impossible to lie to me? The sensors on his forehead take measure of his thoughts, his emotions. He has no secrets from the commander. He has no secrets. What do you remember of your past? The commander presses him. Nothing, he gasps, already anticipating the pain that follows in the next instant. The explosion in his brain casts a shadow of darkness, and for a blissful moment, he is lost. But the commander calls him back, jolts him awake. He wants to obey. He wants to blot out his memories, to empty himself of the past. He struggles to erase it all. He has no name. No history. His life is blank. He remembers nothing but these walls, the light, the commander's voice. Pain. Almost nothing, but there are images. A small girl, blonde, with an innocent smile. A grassy hill, and just beyond it, a lake, cool and refreshing. Two suns blazing against a violet sky. A woman's voice. A hand on his forehead, soft and warm. He wants to forget, but not as much as he wants to remember. They are only images, they are all he has left. Tell me what you remember, the commander says. His finger twitches over the switch that will bring the pain. He would rather die than survive another jolt. And they will not let him die. I remember, a girl, he says softly. She is my sister. Friend? Daughter? But the memory will not come. Only her face. Only her smile. She is mine, he tells the commander. The commander smiles. Not anymore. The hours crept by, as X-7 drew closer and closer to Coruscant. X-7 knew, because he had done extensive research on ordinary behavior, that most beings would feel the need to fill the time. They would fiddle with a datapad, play a game of Dejarik, even gaze out the window at the emptiness of space. And when necessary, X-7 would do the same. On a mission, he was well equipped to fit in. But alone, he had no such need. He had stripped the mattress from his bunk. The rigid durasteel against his back felt comfortably familiar. He appreciated these hours, alone in space. So much of his life was a careful act. Isolated moments like this came as a relief. He could drop the mask and exist as he was. Empty. No one in the galaxy had ever seen X-7 like this, his true self exposed. No one but the commander, of course, who knew him inside and out. As he should. The commander had made him. He faces the commander as an equal, though they will never be equals. There are no more restraints, no more sensors, no more neuronic binders to inflict punishing pain. They are well beyond this. He sits on one side of the desk, the commander on the other. He waits. Congratulations, X-7, the commander says. He holds out a hand, and X-7 knows to shake it. He has been well trained. He can act human. The commander tells him he is human. The commander tells him that the lessons he's learned, how to smile, how to laugh, how to imitate sorrow or fear or joy, are things he used to understand instinctively. That he once was a being like other beings, soft and stupid. He feels sorry for that other self. He is grateful to the commander for eliminating it. I have to admit, I always thought X-3 would be the one, the commander says, shaking his head. He seemed somehow impervious. But he had not been impervious to X-7's vibroblade in their final training bout. X-1 and X-6 had been easily dispatched. X-2 had malfunctioned, tried to escape. X-5 had malfunctioned as well, begun muttering about alliances, and encouraged the others to see the commander as their enemy. That was before X-7's emotions had died away, he had been able to enjoy the kill. X4 hung himself with a laser whip. And then there was one. They were your friends, once, the commander says. Your partners in our exciting new venture. You feel no sorrow over their deaths. He knows the commander is testing him, but they are beyond tests now. He feels no anxiety, he has nothing to hide. I feel nothing, he says honestly, but the desire to obey. The commander nods. You're ready. There's just one last thing. I want to introduce you to someone. He presses a button on his console, and a screen rises from the desk. A face appears. His head is shaved. Young, barely more than a child, but with the eyes of a man, stone gray and cruel. His thin lips are pressed together, a flat line running parallel to the single crease in his forehead. His skin is purpled with fading bruises, and a network of thin scars, spiders across his scalp. Recognize him? The commander asks. X7 shakes his head. The man on the screen shakes his head. X7 opens his mouth to speak. The man on the screen opens his mouth to speak. X7 understands. The commander sees it in his eyes, presses a button, and the mirrored screen drops back into the desk. X7 realizes, this was the final test. He has passed. He is ready. Since X7's last trip to Coruscant, the commander had switched offices. He was now located midway up a towering spire, in the planet's wealthiest quadrant. But this office was identical to the other, lacking in any personal effects. The spare space contained only a desk, a single shelf, and a wall-sized viewscreen. Welcome, the commander said, gesturing for X7 to take a seat. There had been a time when the commander had been the only being he knew. His face had filled X7's world. Now, many missions later, after traveling the galaxy and encountering beings of all kinds, X7 understood that the commander was unusually thin and weak. His watery eyes, his pinched features, his stooped shoulders, they were not the mark of an intimidating man. X7 saw all this objectively, as he saw everything objectively. He saw the being before him as others saw him. Rezi Sorish, he thought, testing the name in his mind, trying to fit it to the man. But it was no use. The man before him would always be the commander, the center of his universe. Pleasing the commander was all he needed in life, disappointing the commander was death. He understood now that this was not natural. This was not the way other beings lived. Other beings had desires of their own, names, identities, histories. X7 had no name, only a designation, like a droid. Other men had free will, while X7 had only Sorish. He knew this to be true, and he knew that Sorish had done this to him. But knowing the truth changed nothing. X7 had free will as well. And, like all other beings, he willed himself to be happy. Happiness was obeying Sorish. The commander passed a data pad across the desk. A valuable piece of Imperial property has been destroyed by the Rebel Scourge. Your target is the pilot who fired the fatal blow. You will infiltrate the Rebel Alliance, gain proof of his identity, and report back. The data pad contains everything we've got on the Alliance. Operations, security protocols, personnel data, everything. X7 nodded. You will arrange to be in a position to kill him, on my command, the commander continued. You will cast the blame on someone else, so that you can remain at the heart of the Alliance. Everything they know, you will know. And everything you know, I will know. For how long? X7 asked. The commander smiled. Until the pilot is dead, and the rebel threat has been eliminated. X7 rose, tucking the datapad securely into his utility pouch. It will be done. Chapter 5. The situation is more dire than even you know, Princess, General Dodonna said, his expression sorrowful. When the general requested a walk through the lush temple grounds, Leia had expected nothing more than an evening of polite conversation. But the general obviously had more serious concerns on his mind, concerns that he preferred to keep between the two of them. A substantial portion of the rebellion's funds were located on Alderaan, the general said. Leia flinched at the name of her home planet. Just hearing the word sent a shockwave through her. Beautiful, peaceful Alderaan, blasted into a billion pieces of space rubble. Every being on the planet ground to dust. Millions of lives, lost in a heartbeat. In her heartbeat, as she stood on the bridge of the Death Star, helpless to stop it. There was nothing she could have done, she knew that. And yet she still hated herself for it. For doing nothing, while her planet, her past, her own father, were lost forever. She forced the memories back inside herself, not wanting to reveal her weakness to General Dodonna. The funds, along with several key financial access codes, were lost with the destruction of the planet, the general continued. We find ourselves in dire straits. Of course, the rebellion lives and breathes through the sacrifices of its brave fighters, but... He sighed. I'm afraid we must not lose sight of the more practical concerns. Without sufficient funding, we'll have no ships, no weapons, no defenses, and no hope of establishing a new base. All the funds were housed on Alderaan, Leia asked, surprised that the rebellion leadership would have been so foolhardy. The general shook his head. This is why I wanted to speak with you. We have a set of secret accounts on the planet Muunilinst. Leia started in surprise. Although the intergalactic banking clan had been disbanded, Muunilinst, its former home, was still the financial heart of the galaxy. And an imperial stronghold. Thanks to their financial skills, the Muuns were one of the few alien species actually tolerated, and even respected, by the Empire. But Leia knew there was still a strong imperial presence on the planet. It will be dangerous to retrieve the funds, General Dodonna admitted. But it must be done. Our contact on the planet, Mac Lunim, is holding a data card containing the access codes. Once you've retrieved them, he's agreed to help you transfer the accounts off-world and get you safely off the planet. Get me safely off the planet? You're the only one I trust for a mission like this, Princess. Not so long ago, in what seemed like another life, Leia had preferred to be addressed by her other title, Senator. Proud as she was of her royal birthright, she was even prouder of the hard work and determination that had gained her a seat in the Galactic Senate. Now, however, the titles seemed interchangeable. The Senate had been. Alderaan was gone. And the person she'd been, the peace-loving princess, the silver-tongued senator, that was gone too. General Riken's expecting me on Delia, in the Alderaan system, Leia reminded him. A group of Alderaan survivors, beings who had been off-world when the Death Star attacked, had begun to assemble there. Leia was eager to join them. She had told General Dodonna that she hoped the survivors might agree to join the Alliance, and this was true. But she also felt a deep need to be with her people, and not just because she was their leader. They were all she had left of her homeworld. They needed her, but she needed them just as much. If all goes well, this should be an easy mission, in and out, the general said. You can go directly from Muunilinst to Delia. That is, if you're willing. Of course, General. This was the only possible response. Whatever the Alliance asked of her, Leia would give. Excellent. I've already arranged transportation, you'll leave tomorrow evening. Mac Lunim is expecting you. And Luke. Luke. I thought it might be best for him to accompany you. He's certainly proven himself as willing and able to assist the cause. And you want him off Yavin 4, in case the Empire comes looking for him, Leia thought. But she couldn't disagree, and she would be glad to have Luke with her. It would have felt wrong to leave him behind. Why is that? She asked herself. She barely knew Luke, and yet in the short time they'd been together, he had come to be important to her. More than that, he seemed almost a part of her. And he's not the only one, she thought. Han's infuriating grin flashed across her mind. Leia shook her head, trying to brush away the image. Focus on the rebellion, she reminded herself. Nothing else matters. I won't let you down, General, she assured him. You never do. He rested a hand on her shoulder, favoring her with a smile. Leia stiffened, suddenly reminded of her father. She had lived for the moments he'd smiled at her like that, loving and proud. She would never see that smile again. Once Leia briefed Luke on the mission, they headed to the spaceport. It was always a good idea to rendezvous with the pilot before a mission, especially since they only had one day to formulate a strategy and assemble supplies. As they approached the hangar deck, Leia spotted Chewbacca wheeling a cart of lubricant hoses toward the Millennium Falcon. As always, the dilapidated Corellian freighter appeared to be held together with tape and good luck, but Leia knew from experience that it was tougher than it looked. Han, leaning against the Falcon's aft hull, offered them a jaunty wave. "What are you still doing here?" Leia asked sourly. "Waiting for my passengers." Han flashed that incredibly annoying smirk of his. "Don't worry, once Chewie finishes tweaking the hyperdrive, he'll lay out a banquet fit for a princess. I know how you royal folks like to travel in luxury." Chewie let out a long, warbling whine. Han rolled his eyes. "I know food service isn't part of your job description, you furry oaf." He leaned toward Leia and lowered his voice to a loud whisper. "That's the problem with Wookiees, can't take a joke." As Chewie roared in protest, Leia forced herself not to smile. She knew Han was just trying to get a reaction out of her, and she wasn't about to comply. "What makes you think I'm going anywhere with you?" Han shrugged. "No one's forcing you, Highness. If you changed your mind about going to Muunilinst, that's your business." Luke's eyes widened. "You're our transportation to Muunilinst." Han gave him a mock salute. "At your service." "Thanks but no thanks, flyboy." Leia shook her head. "This isn't your fight, remember. I'm sure you have better things to do, on the other side of the galaxy." For a second, Han looked wounded. Leia felt guilty. She didn't mean to say things like that to him, they just popped out whenever he was around. If only he wasn't so infuriating. There was just something about him. She often wished she'd never met him, but deep down, a rebellious part of her didn't want him out of her sight. Han scowled. "Look, Your Worship, you know this bird's the fastest and fiercest in the galaxy. You want to get somewhere, the Millennium Falcon's the way to go." "And what's in it for you?" Leia asked suspiciously. "Nothing," Han said. Chewbacca yowled, and Han shot him an annoyed glare. "Okay, fine, so there's a little something in it for me, but it's barely enough to pay for the fuel. Then I'll drop you two on Delia, and you never have to see me again." "I knew it," Luke said, sounding overjoyed. "You can talk all you want about walking away from the rebellion, but when it comes right down to it, you're on our side." "Hey, slow down," Han protested. "I'm just flying you from point A to point B. Trust me, it's not because I'm joining your nutso rebellion." Luke shook his head. "Say what you want, but I know you believe in this fight and want to help." Leia looked at Luke in amazement. He sounded so sure. Like he could look straight through Han and see the truth of his soul. Leia wondered what it would be like to be so certain about people, to look at them without doubt or suspicion. Some might call Luke naive, but there was something bold in his willingness to trust his instincts. Even when they were wrong. "I appreciate the vote of confidence, but you've got me figured all wrong," Han said, sounding almost sorry. "I'm not wrong." There was an unusually steely note in Luke's voice, different from his usual young, questioning tone. "I know you, Han. I can see the good in you, even if you can't. Not everyone has a good side, kid. Not everyone's like you." Han glanced at Leia. They were alike in this, she realized. Both of them saw the danger in Luke's willingness to trust. And maybe, both of them envied it. The sooner you figure that out, the longer you stay alive. Chapter 6. He would begin with Leia. X-7 had no doubts about his plan. Princess Leia Organa was the public face of the rebellion, but the Empire's informants suggested she was more than that. She was a key decision-maker, a diplomat, a leader. She would know the name of the pilot who destroyed the Death Star, and she would have access to him. As the prey bird hurtled toward the rebel base, X-7 skimmed the datapad, soaking in every piece of information that existed on Leia Organa. His training had given him the ability to read and memorize information with great speed, and soon he had become an expert on the Alderaan princess. Everything the Empire knew about Leia, X-7 knew. He knew what she liked, and what she hated. What she respected. Whom she respected. And that was the person he would become. Yavin 4 loomed in the viewscreen, the jungle moon awash in swirls of blue and green. The comm console lit up with an incoming transmission. "You are entering restricted territory," the scratchy voice warned. "Request clearance for landing." The replay came as expected. "Landing code required." X-7 recited the code he'd been given by the commander and armed his laser cannons. He'd been assured that the rebel codes were only a few months old, and that the spy who delivered them could be trusted. Still, he believed in being prepared. "Permission granted. You may land when ready." X-7 smiled. Not because he was happy, but because expressing the emotion he couldn't feel was good practice. Soon, he would be one of them. "Nice and slow," the man said, cocking his blaster as X-7 stepped through the hatch of the prey bird. "And let's keep your hands where I can see them." So they hadn't been fooled by the landing code after all. Smart, X-7 thought in approval. Allowing him to land and let his guard down before revealing themselves as a threat. This way, if he turned out to be an enemy, they could destroy him without destroying his ship. Of course, their strategy assumed that he was more dangerous behind the firing controls of a laser cannon than he was on the ground. It was a poor assumption. The Yavin 4 hangar deck was a hub of bustling activity. X-wing fighters set off for missions while others limped onto the tarmac, bruised and battered. Maintenance droids and deck officers raced from ship to ship, scavenging parts from one to fix another, refitting and refueling with efficient haste. X-7 could see with a glance that there were fewer ships than needed, fewer parts, fewer pilots, fewer everything. It was nearly laughable, the idea that an operation like this could stand up to the Empire. Some might have called it brave. X-7 knew better. "Careful with that, friend," he told the rebel guard, nodding at the blaster. "I'd hate for you to accidentally blow a hole through me." He kept his tone casual. "Wouldn't be anything accidental about it," the guard growled. "Now how about you tell me where you got that landing code?" "From Lieutenant Jez Planchet," X-7 said. "He recruited me about 6 months ago. Gave me orders to bring you a message, and then report for duty. I'm ready to serve the Rebel Alliance, wherever I'm needed." He was prepared for this. He was prepared for anything. The guard narrowed his eyes and flicked a finger across his datapad. "So you ran into Planchet on Kashyyyk, eh?" X-7 forced a thin smile. "Lieutenant Planchet's been deep undercover on Malastare for the last year." "Sir." How amusing that they thought they could trick him. It was like playing a game with a child, carefully manipulating the playing field to give him the illusion that he was among equals. The guard gave a terse nod. "And you have some kind of proof that you are who you say you are?" "Actually, I haven't said who I am, yet," X-7 pointed out. Any respect he might have had was quickly fading. This was no way to run an interrogation. They hadn't even confiscated his weapons. He could kill half the men in this hangar without breaking a sweat. "Shri Bonar. Pleased to meet you." He held out a data pad. Here are my ID docs, and the data planchet had me smuggle out. Their plans for some kind of new Imperial ship. Lieutenant Planchet wanted them to go straight to Dodona. In fact, all Lieutenant Planchet had wanted was a release from the torture he'd endured in his Imperial prison cell. He had indeed spent several months undercover on Malastare, completely cut off from his rebel allies. Which meant when the Empire arrived at his door, he had no one to call for help. And when the Empire's expert interrogators began their work, he had no hope of rescue. According to the commander, Planchet had stayed silent at first, but the human body could only tolerate so much pain. In the end, he had yielded all his rebel secrets, begging only for an end to the torture. And he was given what he'd asked for. Dead men felt no pain. The rebel perused the data pad carefully. X7 knew what he would find. Impeccable credentials proving he was Shri Bonar, a man who'd never existed. Falsified blueprints for a battleship that would never be built. A certifying thumbprint and alliance codes from Lieutenant Planchet, whose rebellion had ended with a whimper and a bolt of blaster fire. Out-of-date codes, yes, but what more could one expect from a man who'd been undercover for nearly a year? "This all appears in order," the guard said, the suspicion fading from his voice. "I better get this info to General Dodona. Lieutenant Planchet specifically requested that I deliver the blueprints personally," X7 said. The rebel shook his head. "Not gonna happen. We've got some new security protocols, can't have you leaving the hangar until everything's been checked out." X7 feigned disappointment. No need to reveal that the hangar was exactly where he wanted to be. "I've been in that ship for a long time," he complained. "I was really looking forward to a good meal, a hot shower." "Trust me, I've been there, pal," the guard cut in. "But we all got to do our part for the rebellion. And right now, your part is to stay right here until I get you clearance. Understood?" X7 nodded. "Understood." The guard left, promising to return with official clearance within the hour. And X7 was left to his own devices. Forbidden from leaving the hangar. Which, of course, was the last thing he wanted to do. He sauntered up to a scarred, rusted Corellian cruiser that matched the specs of a ship Leia Organa had been known to use. A team of maintenance droids was working on the starboard dorsal engine, while a slim, brown-haired man in a deck officer's uniform, struggled with the dorsal rectenna dish. When he paused, looking around for one of his tools, X7 tossed him a fusion cutter. "Trouble with the sensor array?" he asked. "Trouble with everything," the deck officer grumbled. "Can't believe the piece of junk even flies." "Maybe it doesn't," X7 said agreeably. "Ever think about grounding her?" "Ground the Falcon." The deck officer spliced together a set of wires on the electrophotoreceptor. "Don't let Solo hear you say that." "Oh. Solo." X7 filed the name away, and waited. He preferred not to ask questions. It was more effective to stay quiet and let your target fill the silence. "I shouldn't even be working on her," the deck officer grumbled. "Solo never lets anyone near her but that Wookiee." "Fine with me, I say. But they're off in some briefing, just talking, 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 while I'm the one who has to actually do something, is all I'm saying. So I'm stuck mucking about in the grease. Like I don't have better things to do than more repairs on a ship that belongs on the junk heap. Think you'll get it done by the time they have to leave?" X7 kept his voice casual. "Unconcerned. I got a few more hours, and only a couple more repairs to make. Shouldn't be a problem." "In that case, maybe you've got time to take a look at something for me," X7 said, a new plan beginning to coalesce. "Shouldn't take more than a second, I could really use an expert opinion." The deck officer grinned. "That's all I got, buddy. Besides, be nice to work with someone who actually appreciated me, is all I'm saying. That Wookiee's always grunting and growling every time I get my wrench near his deflector shield. And last time I was dumb enough try to touch the hyperdrive. Well, lucky I still have both my arms, is all I'm saying. It's right over here, X7 said, leading the deck officer into a secluded corner of the spaceport. A large pile of damaged generators shielded them from view. I've been having quite a problem. The deck officer looked confused when X7 stopped. Except for a few crates of spare parts, the area was empty. There's no ship here, hey. His shout faded as the injected nerve toxin took effect. The man was dead before he hit the ground. X7 stripped him of his uniform, then slid his body into a crevice in the generator pile where, with any luck, it wouldn't be discovered for days. Problem solved. It took only a few minutes to slip aboard the Millennium Falcon and access the navigational computer, which had been programmed on a course for Muunilinst. Now he knew where they were headed, and, after making a few modifications to the ship systems, he knew exactly how he would intercept them. After that, he needed only to find himself a way off the moon. And what could be simpler? He had the prey bird. He had his blaster. And moments later, he had a young, terrified rebel pilot willing to do anything he asked. A blaster muzzle digging into the ribcage tended to have that effect on people. A more experienced soldier might have turned the situation to his advantage, realizing that X7 couldn't afford to shoot. Not if he wanted to get out alive. A more experienced soldier certainly would have known better than to climb into the prey bird as ordered, and relay the series of codes necessary to gain departure clearance. A more experienced soldier likely would not have believed X7's promise. Do as I say, and I'll let you live. But X7 had chosen well, and this soldier was no soldier at all. He was little more than a scared boy, wearing his uniform like a costume. And, once he'd served his purpose, he was disposable. There was no need to use the blaster. The vacuum of space did the job just fine, without leaving behind a bloody mess. As the pilot's body drifted away into the black, X7 set a course for Muunilinst. It was time to put his plan in motion. The man he needed proved easy to track down. Soon his pinched, grizzled face was looming on the communicator screen. "It'll cost you," the pilot said, once he heard X7's proposal. "Name your price," X7 suggested. "My employer has rather deep pockets." "And you're sure it's safe? Solo's got a reputation, you know. You'd have to be crazy to go up against the Millennium Falcon. Especially in a TIE fighter. Those things practically explode if you sneeze on them. I've taken care of the Falcon. Just show up at the coordinates I've given you. It's completely safe." X7 smiled, offering up a perfect simulation of candid sincerity. "You have my personal guarantee." The Muunilinst system was still hours away when X7 began his transformation. He began with the physical. X7 had been taught to believe that change happened from the outside in. And his specialized med pack made change easy. Painful, but easy. Ignoring the localized nerve anesthetic, he used a small Durasteel mallet to crush his nasal bones. He set them with the bone fuser, adding a bump and a slight curve that gave his face a completely different look. Colored lenses turned his eyes a bright green, and a black tattoo across his neck marked him as a member of the Amari. This was the former ruling class of Malano 3, the planet he would claim as his own. The chances of Leia knowing anything about Malano 3 or the Amari were low, but X7 left nothing to chance. His new identity was that of a warrior, and a warrior needed scars. He raked the sonic scalpel in a jagged line from his left eye to his chin, pleasuring in the pain. There were easier ways, but he preferred the pain. It kept his mind clear. Reminded him of the stakes. Reminded him of the commander, and the only home he'd ever known. A blaster set on stun, aimed at the chest, the back, the shoulders. A simple application of Bacta, and his false identity was complete. A battle-scarred warrior, fresh from the front lines. X7 called up the details of his new persona on the datapad, running his eyes over and over them, although they were already stored in his head. Tobin Elad, he repeated aloud, testing the new name on his tongue. I am Tobin Elad. He watched himself saying it in a plane of mirrored transparesteel, mastering every twitch of the eye, every quirk of the lips, any and every sign that might give away the lie. He practiced smiling, lighting his dead eyes with a life that almost seemed real. He practiced laughing. He practiced the lie of his humanity until he nearly believed it himself. And then he knew he was ready. X7 would sink beneath the surface, poised, waiting for Tobin Elad to get the job done. And when he did, X7 would emerge. And strike. He wiped the details of his false identity from the datapad, and called up the picture of Leia, the one he'd first seen. It was a few years old, from a time before her eyes had taken on their sad, haunted look. She was smiling, her long hair wrapped around her head in an elaborate braid. Her head was inclined slightly forward, as if she were about to share a secret with the holocan. This was the Leia he planned to target. This Leia still existed, he was sure of it. The younger, sweeter Leia, who lived beneath the cynical rebel. The one who longed to connect with someone who could truly understand her, with whom she could share all her secrets. Your wait is almost over, Princess, X7 whispered, his eyes fixed on her face. I'm on my way. Chapter 7. I'm bringing us out of hyperdrive now, Han informed his passengers. We'll be just outside the Muunilinst system, so it should be smooth sailing from here on in. It's about time, Leia complained. If I have to be stuck in this tin can with you for any longer, I'll scream. Stuck with me? Han thought in frustration. She was the one who'd been pestering him the whole trip. Check this, try this, have you thought of that, and on, and on. The princess just didn't know how to keep her mouth shut. Feel free to get out here, Han retorted, gesturing to the gleaming strands of stars whipping past the ship. Say the word and I'll just drop you right out the hatch. You'd really do it, wouldn't you? Leia asked incredulously. You bet I would, sweetheart. Chewbacca growled. Oh yes I would, Han insisted. And if you don't stop taking her side, you can go with her, you hairy fuzzball. Chewbacca yowled. Han rolled his eyes as he took the ship out of hyperdrive. Since when are you so sensitive, Chewie? I was just, whoa. The ship shuddered. What's happening? Leia cried, almost tumbling into his lap. She caught herself just in time. Someone's shooting at us, Princess. In case you hadn't noticed. Han pulled the Falcon around, trying to get a glimpse of his attacker. The guy was right on his tail. Han jerked the ship up, then hard to starboard, dodging another blast of laser fire. There's someone shooting at us, Luke cried, already scrambling down the tube that led to the ventral quad laser cannons. You don't say. Han accelerated, trying to get some distance from the attacker, who was a good shot. He took the Falcon into a screaming dive, then pulled up, hard, drawing level with the enemy. Gotcha, he shouted, as the TIE fighter came into view. Kid, why aren't we blowing this Imperial slug brain out of the sky? Something's wrong. Even over the staticky comlink, the alarm in Luke's voice came through loud and clear. The weapon system is offline. Well, get it online. Han jerked his head at Chewie, but the Wookiee was already on his way, closely followed by R2-D2. Sir, might I suggest evasive action, C-3PO put in. Excellent suggestion, Han said through gritted teeth. He took them into a corkscrew dive. Wish I'd thought of that myself. Still, we must get the lasers back online, Captain Solo, C-3PO added. The bucket of bolts was just a fount of helpful advice. Otherwise I'm afraid I estimate our odds at 7,336 to. What did I say about quoting me odds? Han increased the forward thrust. The ship bucked and shuddered as Imperial laser fire blasted their deflector shield. They were too close to the moons of Muunilinst to safely go into hyperdrive, but if he could get just a little room. "What are you doing?" Leia asked in alarm.
"Running away," Han snapped.
"Unless you still think that's the coward's way."
"No, running away is good," Leia said quickly.
"Let's go."
"But why can't we just go into hyper?"
Leia fell silent, as a second ship dropped out of hyperdrive.
"Company," Han said grimly. "A rusted Preybird starfighter.
No match for the Falcon, if the Falcon could shoot.
He had to get out of there, fast.
Their shields couldn't take another direct hit.
And if the deflector system failed, too."
"Wait."
Leia gripped his shoulder.
"Look."
The new ship swooped toward the TIE.
Laser fire lit up the sky.
The fighter swung sharply to port, returning fire.
It scored a direct hit on the Preybird.
"What's he doing?" Han said, wondering what kind of nut was piloting the ship.
"That old ship can't take that kind of fire."
The Preybird dodged the next round and unleashed a laser blast of its own.
The ships danced around each other, laser fire exploding on all sides.
Han could do nothing but watch.
He hated it.
"What's going on with those laser cannons?" he shouted.
This was his fight.
"No luck," Luke called back.
"The cannons are jammed, and even if we could get them working, we have no targeting capability.
The whole system's gone haywire."
"Great," Han muttered.
"Just great."
He swung the ship around and accelerated, heading straight for the TIE fighter.
"What are you doing?" Leia asked, panic filling her voice.
"What happened to running away?"
"Change of plans," Han said, pushing the ship faster.
"We don't have any weapons."
"Glad you've been paying attention."
The TIE loomed in his sights.
"But he doesn't know that.
That other ship is doing just fine."
"I don't know about you, Highness, but I fight my own battles."
"And how, exactly, are we supposed to fight without any weapons?"
The TIE fighter loomed in the viewscreen.
They were almost on top of it.
"We'll figure that out when we—"
"He's retreating," Leia exclaimed.
"Of course he is," Han said calmly, trying to disguise his shock
and relief.
The Preybird took off after the fleeing TIE fighter, firing a single shot to its starboard solar array wing.
The Imperial ship exploded.
Han tensed, waiting for the Preybird to make a move.
Sure, the other pilot had helped them out of a jam.
But in his experience, people only helped you when they wanted something.
Maybe this guy wanted his cargo.
Or his ship.
"How we doing with those laser cannons?" Han asked nervously.
A transmission came in over the comlink.
"Calrissian freighter, this is, request assistance."
Only a few clear words bubbled up through the storm of static.
"Damaged my, and power generator, forced to, not sure if I, please send."
The call cut off abruptly.
They watched in horror as the ship belched out a plume of black exhaust, then dipped precariously toward a nearby moon.
The Preybird glowed orange with heat as it plummeted through the atmosphere, and then disappeared beneath the clouds.
Leia's eyes widened with horror.
"We have to go after him."
"I thought the only thing that mattered was the mission, Princess," Han teased, quoting words she'd fired at him 100 times.
She looked at him in disgust.
"He saved us.
Now he's our responsibility."
"Hey, no one asked for his help," Han grumbled.
But he'd already set a course for the surface.
That was the thing about Leia. She never understood when he was joking.
It was almost like she wanted to think the worst of him.
So let her, he thought.
Why should he care?
He shouldn't.
But he did.
It took them almost an hour to find the crash site.
Magnetic disturbances in the moon's atmosphere made it difficult to pick up the Preybird's distress beacon until they were right on top of it.
But they finally found the ship, or what was left of it.
The Preybird lay at the base of a jagged cliffside, smashed nearly to pieces. Leia caught her breath. Do you think he's...
Well, I doubt he's having a tea party in there, Han said, keeping his voice light to cover his concern. No reason to upset the others, at least until there was a reason. But only one way to find out. The moon was uninhabited, and Han could see why. The air was dense and murky, rich with the scent of oxite. The bluish globe of Muunilinst hung overhead, on the opposite side of the sky from the dim, jaundiced sun. Scrub brush littered the dusty ground, spotting the dirt-gray hills of rock and clay that stretched to the horizon. There was no movement or sound in the heavy air, the world seemed still and dead. Except. There's no one inside, Luke reported, after examining the prey bird wreckage.
Black scorch marks scraped across what was left of the hull.
At least we know he's not dead.
Not yet.
Han pointed toward the large inhuman tracks, leading toward, and then away from the ship, disappearing into the hills. A thin groove in the dirt followed the footsteps, as if the creature had dragged something behind it. The groove was stained with a trail of blood.
Chapter 8. Blood seeped through the bandage. A crimson stain spread swiftly across his shirt. He'd slashed himself deeper than intended, and could feel the life pumping out of him with each step. No matter. They would find him when he was ready to be found. And when that happened, a graver injury could only work in his favor. No one would ever guess that the gashes had come from his fire blade rather than the crash. X7 had waited an hour before activating the distress beacon, and in the meantime, he'd been busy. After laying the trail, he'd doubled back, lying in wait for his rescuers to arrive. Now he shadowed them as they followed the tracks he'd laid, leaving the Wookiee and the little R2 droid to guard the ship. He watched closely as the princess forged ahead, the two men scrambling to keep up with her. So the princess was foolhardy, her friends powerless to stop her from blundering into trouble.
Interesting.
X7 filed it away for future reference. He tread silently and stayed close. From a few paces behind, he could hear them bickering, could hear the protocol droid complaining, could hear the two men dither over which way to go as the tracks faded. They didn't look like much of a threat. Still, X7 knew better than to trust his first impression. Many men had made that mistake when encountering him. Few lived to make it a second time. Wincing at the pain in his shoulder, he drew out his dart shooter. Took aim at the taller male, and fired. The man slapped at the back of his neck, then examined his palm, likely looking for the insect that had bitten him. Then shrugged, and continued walking. X7 paused, letting them get further ahead. He didn't want to be too close when the pheromone dart did its job, releasing a scent that would draw the nearest reek. When the beast found a group of humans instead of a potential mate, X7 suspected it would be rather displeased. Once the creature attacked, X7 would draw closer again, watching them defend themselves. It would be the best way to gauge their weaknesses. And, if the beast was able to slaughter the one exuding the pheromones, so much the better. X7 would intercede, before it could harm the princess. She could hardly refuse to trust him, after that. There was a faint roar in the distance. A moment later, the ground began to shake. Here it comes, X7 thought. Let the games begin. Luke grabbed hold of the nearest boulder, trying to keep his balance as the ground rumbled. Moonquake, he asked. Leia shook her head, pointing a finger over his shoulder. Luke whirled around. A giant beast lumbered toward them on legs thick as tree trunks. Its hunched back rose to nearly three times Luke's height. A horn stuck out of each side of its face, while a third spurted from its forehead, sharp as a knife and thicker at its base than a human torso. It looks like a reek. Luke drew his lightsaber. The huts on his home planet sometimes used them as execution animals. They're mostly herbivores, but... Han yelped, lunging out of the way as the reek swiped at him with a trunk-like leg.
but when their skin turns all reddish-brown like that, it usually means they've got a taste for meat, Luke admitted. Han whipped out his blaster and took aim, but the blaster fire bounced off the reek's tough hide. I'm no one's meat, he shouted, scrambling up a shallow hill of rocks to get a better angle. The reek lowered its head and charged. Get down, princess, Han called to Leia, as he dove out of the way just in time. She ducked behind the nearest rocky outcropping. C-3PO was already cowering beneath it. Leia elbowed him aside and began blasting at the reek with her laser pistol. Han fired again, but the reek only grunted, charging straight through the blaster bolts. Luke raised his lightsaber, but froze. What good was a lightsaber against a creature like this? Even if he could get close enough to strike, he'd probably be crushed before he could do any good. A lightsaber is the only weapon a Jedi needs, Ben had told him. Easy for Ben to say, Luke thought now. He knew how to use it. Forget the toy, Han yelled, running at full speed from the lumbering reek. He paused every few seconds to turn back and shoot, aiming for a different spot each time, in hopes of finding a weakness in the thick hide. But it was no use, and the reek showed no signs of tiring. Blast the thing before it has me for dinner. The blasters aren't hurting it, Luke shouted back. At the sound of his voice, the reek turned around, as if noticing him for the first time. It grunted, stomped, and then took off for Luke. It was too close, and coming too fast. He couldn't get out of the way. Luke fumbled for his blaster, but it got caught in its holster. The reek drew closer. Hey, what about me? Han yelled, trying to distract it again. Dinner's this way, you horn-faced jerk. But the reek was fixed on Luke. He knew if he tried to run, he could be trampled beneath the beast's mammoth feet before he got more than a few paces. So he held his ground. He raised his lightsaber, focusing on the shimmering blue blade, trying to block out his fear. Luke remembered Han's strategy with the TIE fighter. I may not be strong enough to kill the reek, Luke thought, but the reek doesn't know that. He ran toward the beast. Luke, Leia screamed. No. Luke stumbled over a large rock bulging out of the dirt. He hurtled wildly through the air, blade outstretched, and landed with a thump a few feet away, flat on his face. A keening howl split his eardrums, and then, with a thunderous crack, the world seemed to crumble beneath him. A moment later, all was silent and still. Luke rolled over and looked up at the concerned faces of his friends. I'm not dead, he said in confusion. Han laughed, but Luke could see the concern beneath the smile. Don't sound so disappointed, kid. Luke sat up, his head throbbing. What happened? You tripped and fell flat on your face, Han said. Yeah, that part I remember. He rubbed the back of his head, then twisted it from side to side, freezing as he caught sight of the mighty reek, dead. Oh. Right, Han said, following his gaze. There was also the part where your lightsaber sliced our friend here wide open. Poor guy was just trying to get a snack. That poor guy nearly had us all for a three-course meal, Leia exclaimed, giving Han a light smack on the shoulder. She tugged Luke up off the ground. Are you sure you're okay? Luke couldn't take his eyes off the reek. He'd really done it, he'd saved the day, with his lightsaber. If only he hadn't done it, by accident. Master Luke, I think I've picked up the trail again, C-3PO reported, gesturing to the bloody footsteps that tramped further into the hills. Luke shuddered. Now that he knew what kind of creature was responsible for those tracks, he was even more worried about the fate of the injured pilot. They had to find him before it was too late. For almost half an hour, they followed the trail across the rocky landscape. It ended at the mouth of a cave. Han and Luke exchanged a glance. Luke guessed they were both thinking the same thing, something had gone into that cave. Probably something they didn't want to meet. Leia gave them both a disgusted look, then strode inside. After you, Han said dryly. but he hurried after her. Luke followed.
If it's all the same to you, I'll just wait out here, Master Luke, C-3PO called. I think I can be of the most service if I...
His voice faded away as they penetrated deeper into the dark cave.
I think I see something, Leia whispered, striding ahead.
Yeah, but does it see us? Han muttered.
There was a body sprawled against the far wall of the cave.
Leia hurried over, kneeling by its side.
Luke and Han approached more slowly, keeping an eye on the mouth of the cave.
The man was bloodied and pale, but his eyes were open.
You shouldn't have followed me, he rasped, struggling to breathe.
It's coming.
He broke off into a fit of coughing.
This is where it...
He exploded into more coughs, then fell backward, exhausted by the effort.
What's he trying to say? Han asked.
Sensing a familiar rumble beneath his feet, Luke drew his lightsaber.
I think he's saying, this is where it lives, he cried, as a reek burst into the cave.
Leia flung herself across the wounded pilot, shielding him with her body.
Han grabbed his blaster.
The reek lowered its horn and charged.
Blasting it doesn't work, Luke complained.
Let me handle this.
You had so much fun the first time, Han shot back.
That was just a fluke.
Keep out of the way and try not to get yourself hurt.
But if you shoot that off in here, you'll...
Before Luke could finish, Han pulled the trigger, aiming for the mouth of the cave.
Blaster fire ricocheted off the roof, dislodging a hail of giant rocks that rained down on the reek's head.
The beast went down in a heap.
See, kid, Han said triumphantly.
I told you I'd...
He broke off, as the ceiling continued to crumble, an avalanche of rocks tumbling down.
They pressed themselves against the cave wall, as clouds of dust billowed up from the massive collapse.
Moments later, the thunder of falling rocks died away.
The dust cleared.
And a wall of solid rock blocked off their only escape.
Handle it, Han finished in a weak voice.
They were trapped.
Chapter 9.
Don't you look at me like that, Han warned the others, as they turned to glare at him.
It's not my fault.
Oh, really? Leia said dryly.
Look, princess, I don't know what it's like where you come from, but where I come from, you shoot the giant scaly monster that's trying to eat you.
As he spoke, Han ran his hands along the wall of rock, searching for an opening.
If he could just pry a few of the rocks loose, he might be able to dig them out.
But hard as he tugged, none of the rocks would budge.
They were wedged solid.
I didn't have a choice, Han insisted, aware that he was getting dangerously close to whining.
What did you want me to do?
You could have let Luke handle it, like he asked, Leia pointed out.
The kid and his glorified nerf steak knife?
Han gaped at Leia.
Was she crazy?
We'd all be reek feed by now.
He paused, glancing at Luke, who was standing off to the edge of the cave, his back to the rest of them.
Probably practicing some kind of Jedi meditation trick.
Luke always picked the strangest times to go all mystical on them.
No offense.
Offense taken, Luke murmured, concentrating on whatever foolish thing he was doing.
Han turned back to the princess, who was still tending to the wounded pilot.
If she would just let him explain what he'd been thinking.
You weren't quite thinking, buddy, said an annoying voice in his head.
That's the problem.
He ignored it.
Look, C-3PO's out there, Han said.
Maybe he'll be able to dig us out.
Leia didn't have to say anything, she just looked at him.
Han sighed.
Fine.
Then I'm sure he'll go get Chewie.
A Wookiee is just what we need.
The comlinks weren't working, thanks to all the magnetic interference, but surely the droid would figure out what to do on his own.
He's probably on his way back to the ship right now, unless he stopped to impress a reek with one of his 6 million languages, Han added under his breath.
Or fell in a ditch.
Leia glared.
If we die in here, I'll kill you.
Han opened his mouth to point out that didn't make any sense, but stopped himself, just in time. "We're not going to die, Your Highness," he assured her. "I'm sure even you can get by for a few hours without your ladies in waiting, or whatever it is you princesses need to survive." "Maybe I can," she snapped, "but he can't." She nodded toward the injured man, lying in a pool of blood. "I've done what I can for him here, but the wound is bleeding out of control. We have to get him back to the ship. A few hours might be too long." The pilot groaned. "That's some bedside manner you have there," he said. Han arched an eyebrow at Leia. She scowled. "I thought he was unconscious," she said, defensively. "You're quite the medical expert," Han teased. "I'd suggest you take over," Leia shot back, "but you'd probably try to blast him back to health." "Hey," Han protested. But Leia turned her back to him, murmuring something comforting to the pilot. "Some rescue attempt," the man complained, his voice weak. "Try a little gratitude," Han suggested. If he was strong enough to dish it out, he was strong enough to take it. "We're the ones doing you a favor." "A favor might have been letting me rescue myself," the man said. Han snorted. "Yeah, you were doing a great job, lying here on the floor of the cave waiting to get eaten. Brilliant plan." "Reeks are herbivores," the pilot said in a superior tone. Han hated superior tones. "Funny, I guess no one told that guy," he said, gesturing toward the definitely carnivorous reek lying dead on the floor of the cave. "Face it, buddy, if it weren't for me, you'd be lunch." "You're right." His voice broke off into another coughing fit. "This is a definite improvement." "Han, leave the poor man alone," Leia said angrily. "He needs his rest." "Me?" Han asked, incredulous. "He started it." Leia shook her head. "I know you have the mind of a 5-year-old, but that's no reason to act like one." "You? How can you?" "I?" Han sputtered, searching for the perfect response. Finally, he told himself it wasn't worth it. He turned to Luke, who was fumbling with his lightsaber over on the far end of the cave. "How about you? Don't you want to tell me what I'm doing wrong?" Luke offered up a serene smile. "Actually, I was thinking I might get us out of here, unless you two aren't done arguing yet." Leia looked up, surprised. "You can get us out of here." "He's bluffing," Han said confidently. Then he took a closer look at Luke. "You're bluffing, right?" Ignoring him, Luke strode toward the wall of rock blocking their exit and plunged his glowing lightsaber into the pile. It sliced through the rocks like they were made of air. "I tested it first," Luke explained, "to make sure the beam was strong enough, and to make sure it wouldn't just cause the rocks to cave in even more." "Thinking before you act," Leia said, giving Han a pointed look. "Imagine that." Luke began cutting through the rock, methodically working the saber back and forth to carve out an opening. It was slow going, and Han could see it was going to take a while, but it would work. "Good thinking," he said. Luke was a little clueless some of the time, okay, most of the time. But Han had to admit it, the kid came through in a pinch. "I told you the lightsaber was a valuable weapon," Luke said. "Hey, don't get ahead of yourself," Han argued. "Slicing and dicing a pile of rocks doesn't exactly qualify something as a weapon. It's no blaster." "Lucky for us," Luke pointed out. Han grimaced. "If you're going to keep throwing that back in my face every time I—" "Not to interrupt," the pilot interrupted, "but less arguing and more cutting would probably be—" He broke off abruptly. "Probably be what?" Han asked irritably. "What made this guy think he could tell them what to do?" "He's out cold," Leia said, concern filling her voice. "Luke, you've got to hurry. We have to get him back to the ship soon, or—" She didn't finish, but she didn't have to. Han joined Luke's side, pushing rocks out of the way as Luke's glowing blade widened the opening. He'd seen men lose that much blood before, and he knew what it meant. That pilot had to return to the ship soon, or he wouldn't be going anywhere at all, ever again.
Chapter 10. Leia rested a hand gently on the pilot's forehead. He was still so pale, but at least the fire no longer burned beneath his skin. They had brought him back to the ship and soaked his wounds in Bacta, but beyond that, there was little they could do for him. The Millennium Falcon was equipped with only the most basic medical provisions. As Han, Luke, and Chewbacca worked to put the weapon systems back online, Leia had sat by the anonymous pilot's bed, waiting for him to wake up. It had been nearly a day. "We don't even know who he is," Leia thought, watching his eyeballs twitch faintly beneath his lids. "If he dies out here, no one who loves him will ever know what happened." She tried not to think about it. After all, his pulse was strong. His wounds were healing. There was no reason to think he wouldn't make a full recovery. If he ever woke up. They owed him so much, she thought. He'd saved them from certain death at the hands of the Empire. Whoever he was, whatever his motives, there was no escaping that truth. They owed him. "But if you want us to pay you back, you're going to have to wake up," she murmured. "You drive a hard bargain." Leia started in surprise, jerking her hand away from his forehead. "You're awake. Seems that way." He smiled, and tried to sit up, groaning at the effort. Gently, she pushed him back down to the bunk. They were in a cramped room just off the main hold, where Han had stored his meager medical supplies. "Easy," she told him. "You lost a lot of blood." He grimaced. "That wasn't part of the plan."
"What plan?"
A strange, blank look flashed across his face, and then it was gone, so quickly that Leia thought she might have imagined it. Especially when he smiled. His eyes sparkled with good humor, and some of the color seemed to come back into his face. "The plan where I rescue the fair maiden and reap her eternal gratitude." Leia suppressed a grin. This was still a stranger, she reminded herself, and they were at war. You couldn't trust every would-be hero with a charming smile. Just look at Han, she thought. Hero one moment, scoundrel the next. The galaxy could be a confusing place. If you're well enough to flirt, you're well enough to answer some questions, she said sternly. Want to tell me what you were doing out there, fighting someone else's battle? Is that your way of saying thank you? The pilot asked. Because if so, you and your blast-happy friend have some work to do on the etiquette front. Leia sighed. Thank you. Now, what were you doing out there? What were you doing out there? He countered. Who are you people, anyway? I asked first, Leia said, biting down hard on the corners of her lips to trap another grin. Indeed you did. The pilot looked thoughtful for a moment. Truth. That would be nice. He raised a hand, wincing at the effort. She shook, being careful not to squeeze too hard. Tobin Elad, he told her. Dissident, guerrilla warrior, exile, orphan, and rather atrocious poet. Though not in that order. Leia, she said, keeping her surname to herself. Professional damsel in distress, he suggested, when it was clear she wouldn't be offering any additional information. I prefer to rescue myself, thank you very much. I'll keep that in mind for the future, he said lightly. Wouldn't want to overstep. You call yourself a warrior, Leia said. That means you have an enemy. He grew serious at once. We all have an enemy. The Empire. Again, he tried to push himself into a sitting position. This time, despite the pain, he made it upright. Though I suppose some of us have more reason to fight than others. Leia suspected that the pain written across his face had nothing to do with his wounded shoulder. And your reason? She asked softly. Reasons, he admitted. Three of them. Or hundreds of thousands. Depending on how you count. He fell silent. Leia waited, letting him go forward at his own pace. He kept his eyes fixed over her shoulder,
gazing intently at the wall of instrument panels behind her head. She took in the faded bruises on his arms and torso, the network of scars crisscrossing his weathered face. He was a few years younger than Han, but the darkness in his eyes made him appear much, much older. "At first, I wanted only peace," he said, his voice barely audible. "Peaceful coexistence with the Empire. Preservation of our way of life. Have you ever been to Malano 3? Leia shook her head. She knew it was a world just beyond the galactic core, but she had never been. "It's a beautiful place," he said. "Trees everywhere. Even our cities were idols of green, laced through with crystalline blue rivers. And we are a peaceful people." He frowned. "Were. We were peaceful. But that wasn't enough for the Empire. No, it wasn't enough that we obey quietly. They wanted our cities, they wanted our land. They wanted to turn our quiet planet into a home for their armies and their weapons installations. Cover the land with barracks and factories. Turn its citizens into workers. Work, that was their term." His face twisted. "I called it what it was. Slavery." "The Empire must have appreciated that," Leia said wryly. "Not so much," he agreed. "Those of us who objected were soon driven out. We who had been peaceful objectors became saboteurs, sneaking into the city in the dead of night, setting explosives, struggling to regain control." He shook his head. "We were fools. I see that now. Insane to think the Empire could be deterred." "It's never foolish to fight for what's right," Leia said fiercely. "It's foolish to deny what you know to be the truth. And the truth is, we were few, we were weak. The Empire was strong. If they'd only punished us." His throat choked off the words. Then he cleared his throat. When he spoke again, his tone was nearly expressionless. "Mirabel, that was our capital. They used thermal detonators to create a firestorm that consumed the whole city. Thousands upon thousands died. Everyone I'd ever cared about. Everyone I'd ever known. My wife." He hung his head, and continued in a whisper. "My child. I'm sorry." They were such small, pathetic words. Nothing, in the face of what he'd lost. And Leia understood loss. "It was a long time ago," Elod said, his voice stony. Leia recognized that tone, that hardness. "You had to block out the storm of emotions, forget the past, if you were going to go on. I'm on my own now, hitting back at the Empire where and when I can. That's what I was doing when we crossed paths. I figured if I could get my hands on a TIE fighter, I could fly right into the heart of the Empire, really do some damage before they caught on." "A single ship against the Imperial fleet?" Leia asked in horror. "But that's certain death." He nodded. "I guess I owe you and your crew an apology. I'd been planning to force that Imperial into a crash landing on the moon, but I guess I chased him right into your path. So saving us ruined your plan?" "Revenge can wait a little longer," Elod said. "To be honest, it's the only thing left keeping me going. When you've lost as much as I have." He shook his head. "You wouldn't understand. I hope you'll never have to." Leia rested a hand lightly on his. "I understand." She needed only to say the word, and he would see. Alderaan. It filled her mind, every day, every minute. Their faces, their voices. The lush, green parks, filled with children on a summer's day. The sweet scent of teal, blossoming over a meadow. Her father's embrace. Gone. They lived inside of her, but she trapped them within. The pain was too fresh, too raw. It was too hard. And yet suddenly, it seemed all too easy to let it out. "Sometimes I fear the fight is all that keeps me going," she told him. "I draw breath, I eat, I move forward, only because I know the fight must continue. Maybe that's why I fight so hard. because if I didn't have that. Leia stopped. She'd never admitted that to anyone before. Maybe not even to herself. And this was a stranger. What was she doing? If you didn't have that, you fear there'd be nothing left. It didn't sound like a question. Leia stood up abruptly. I should let the others know you're awake, she said brusquely. They've been concerned. I'm not going anywhere, Elod pointed out. They can wait. She was tempted to stay, to talk, and that decided her. Someone will be back to check on you soon, she told him, backing out of the small room. She needed to get away from this man, to stay away from him. He tempted her to trust too much, too easily, and that way led only to danger. Lie back. Rest. He followed orders, poorly disguising a sigh of relief, as his head hit the pillow. Thank you, Leia. For sitting with me. It seems I haven't had anyone to talk to, really talk to, in a long time. It felt surprisingly good. Sometimes you just need someone to listen to you, Leia said, shifting uncomfortably under the weight of his stare. Yes, he said, gazing so intently that she feared he could see right into her head. Sometimes you do. The severity of his injury had been unexpected, but it had worked to his advantage. X7 made everything work to his advantage. It was the only way he'd stayed alive for as long as he had. The princess had bought the act completely. He could tell from the glassy sheen that fell across her eyes when he unspooled the lies about a dead wife and child. Soon she would open up to him, tell him whatever he needed to know. X7 regained his strength quickly, but feigned weakness over the course of the next 2 days. Hobbling around the ship gave him a chance to observe the crew. And certainly no one would expect the brave, wounded hero to pose a threat. They'd put the weapon systems back online, and were now in a stable orbit around Muunilinst. X7 suspected they were waiting to decide what to do with him before they made their next move. His next job was to convince them he could be trusted with the content of their rebel mission, the first of many rebel secrets he would possess. He bided his time, he watched. Humans were sad creatures, he thought, so unaware of their own selves, their own weaknesses. Leia and the captain, Han, for example. They argued ceaselessly, oblivious of the energy that lay beneath the surface of their every encounter. Neither understood the unspoken bond they shared. But X7 saw it, and this was knowledge he could exploit. And the boy. Now there was an interesting case. When Luke had faced the reek with his lightsaber, X7 had nearly given himself away with a gasp of surprise. He'd heard of the Jedi, of course, but everyone knew they were long extinct. Yet, somehow the boy possessed the weapon of a Jedi, even fancied himself a Jedi, despite the fact that he could barely strike a blow without falling on his face. There was strength there, X7 knew. But it was well hidden, buried so deep, that Luke might never find it. The boy was too innocent, too trusting. And this, too, was something that X7 could use. While X7 suspected Han Solo might be persuaded to sell his information for the right price, Luke might offer it up for free. Either could easily prove to be the weak link he needed. Yes, someone on this ship would lead him straight to the being who had destroyed the Death Star. It was only a matter of time. End of chapter. This book is part of our exclusive series available to Patreon supporters. If you would like to listen to this entire book, please visit patreon.com/yjkaudiobooks. The link is also available in the video description below. Thank you for listening, and may the Force be with you, always.